Hello and welcome to Health Professional Radio. I'm your host, Neil Howard. Real glad that you could join us for another segment. We're going to be speaking with Vanuth Kulami. She's joining us here from Stanford Children's Health to discuss ways for families to model a compassionate and more sustainable approach to nutrition for their children during the holiday season. Welcome to Health Professional Radio, Vanuth Kulami. Thank you so much for joining us this morning.
Thank you, Neil, for having me. It's a pleasure.
You're associated with Stanford Children's Health. Give us a little bit of your professional background and talk a bit about your role at Stanford Children's Health, if you would.
Totally. I would be more than happy to. Well, I'm a pediatric clinical dietitian here at Stanford Children's Health, and I completed training actually at Stanford University, San Jose State and Tufts University. But mainly I focus on nutrition for children of all ages, especially within the realm of gastrointestinal conditions, so digestive conditions. Within that, I even have a niche specialty of working with children who have inflammatory bowel disease, which is also known by the acronym IBD, as well as children who have celiac disease. And there I kind of work to provide disease-specific nutritional counseling that's not only tailored to the condition, but also to the individual and the family. And this is what I like to call more of a compassionate nutrition approach, really trying to make whatever I do with families sustainable, individualized, and really culturally sensitive. I've also been involved in some research work, so looking at the effects of diet on IBD, teaching kitchens, and even using virtual reality for education for patients with celiac. So I wear a number of different hats too, but ultimately my main objective is really bringing in sustainable and compassionate nutrition interventions to families.
Now, not only across the board, I mean, anytime, but especially during the holidays, I mean, you mentioned some serious conditions in childhood, IBD, celiac disease. Many of these conditions, it doesn't matter what time of the year it is. You have to really, really be diligent about your treatment regimen, about your diet. But is it the adults that are to blame when it comes to kind of being lax when it comes to the holidays? I mean, isn't this a time to just kind of cut loose? I mean, you know, save for the conditions, that doesn't matter. But, you know, just regular childhood nutrition, can't we just cut loose for a few weeks during the holidays?
I love that approach. And to answer your previous question, I don't think there's any blame to be put on anybody, right? We live in a world that's so demanding, and the lifestyle nowadays is really kind of unforgiving to parents. We have the biggest shortage of time. So I think the holidays, there is a balance to be struck. I think understandably, a lot of people go into the holidays feeling like, oh goodness, there's so many treats and quote unquote unhealthy foods that I need to maneuver around as if it's an obstacle course. And it's especially stressful for parents because they're ultimately in charge of what their children are eating, what they're being offered. On the other hand, I do kind of view the holidays as a time to kind of focus more on the togetherness, the celebratory aspect of holidays, and not getting too caught up in the food rules. So this can mean like having a bit more structure, but still being flexible, knowing that this is a time to celebrate and build memories, and that we don't need to be, you know, working towards some sort of squeaky clean the most nutritious diet of our lives, right?
What are some tips for kind of striking that balance?
Totally. Well, to back up a little bit too, the idea of like a sustainable nutrition approach, it sounds so radically simple. But I think we live in a world nowadays where our relationships with food and nutrition in our bodies is probably at an all-time low. And I can say that because we've had reports about, you know, sodium intake being at an all-time high, unprecedented pandemic-related weight gain, disordered eating on a steep rise, especially amongst adolescents. So we know these are all conditions where, you know, our relationships with food are skewed to some extent, and we need to work toward repairing that. And the goal here is kind of to take an approach where we have a sustainable, long-lasting kind of plan for our nutrition and our food that lasts beyond the holidays. So maybe next time around, you know, next year when the holidays strike again, we're not worried about, oh my gosh, how am I going to maneuver around this? So the main three things that I like to really dig into and the three things I like to break it down to is ditching antiquated adages around diet, fostering mindfulness and tuning into intuitive eating, and then leaning on your village, asking for help. And I'd be happy to dive into what each of these categories means.
Well, what are some antiquated adages around health and nutrition, especially during the holidays?
Yeah, there's definitely a lot. So some of them can look like, family saying like, oh, new year, new me, as if the current you is not good enough. Mm-hmm. Or, when the new year strikes, I'm going to lose like 20 pounds in 2 weeks. Or, well, if I eat a slice of chocolate cake, then that means I'm going to spend 2 hours on this, dear master. Mm-hmm. And, all these sort of phrases, they're said sort of in a harmless way, but they're accepted, right? It's okay to say these things. And the reason they're kind of okay to say is because there's something out there called diet culture. And this is a widely accepted kind of cultural practice of taking a semi-punitive approach to food, nutrition, weight, and body image. What we want to do here is to flip the script on this. Food is fun. Our bodies are made to eat. We eat to nourish them. So what if we tried something just radically different and entertain the idea of trusting our body? This is where sustainable nutrition comes in. Now, I think this it's important to recognize this sort of role of diet culture on the parent. And it's important because your children look up to you. They absorb what you say. They mimic what you do. You are their role model. So modeling these healthy behaviors and relationships with food can do a world of help for your children. That might mean by starting with the parent or the caregiver and adjusting the language that you use around food and maybe even questioning some beliefs that you hold around nutrition and body weight. So, instead of new year, new you, you could accept the current you and work on making current you better, right? We can love ourselves now and still be trying to improve ourselves. Instead of, modeling a crash diet, what if we took time to tune into our body telling us when it's hungry and telling us when it's full, and teaching our children to do the same?
Should an understanding of that diet culture be part of this mindfulness or this intuition when it comes to your eating approach and lifestyle?
That's a fantastic question. And you know what? I haven't thought about it to that detail, but I'll tell you that I think to some extent, yes, because we are all born as kind of intuitive eaters that we eat when we're hungry, we stop when we're full. If you look like at an infant who breastfeeds or drink formula, no one is regulating how much they eat. And yet as we get older, we are told to regulate how much we eat, or others are telling us to regulate ourselves. So having this awareness of diet culture, which sort of promotes this distrust with ourselves, can be helpful to have a grounding and know, like, okay, what am I trying to get back to, which is intuitive eating. So, which brings me to, what is intuitive eating? And intuitive eating, put very simply, is really listening to your body, knowing when it's hungry, stopping when it's full, feeding it regularly, not depriving it, but also honoring cravings, honoring when it's hungry off schedule, right? Our bodies are, fantastically engineered systems that can communicate really intricately between the gut and the brain to tell us when we're hungry and not. What's nice about intuitive eating is that we move away from this like good or bad, black and white sort of approach to nutrition, and we can challenge ourselves to live in this more nuanced gray area. So, one of my favorite ways to shift language around food and expanding vocabulary from good to bad to just describing food without passing judgment or shame or morality is doing like a mindful eating exercise where you really mindfully eat a piece of food, like for an example, tangerine, and you just notice it's tangy, it's sexy, it's juicy, but we're not saying, oh, it's so good for you. Mm-hmm. Or likewise, a donut where it's like, okay, there's like a kind of, crunchy sort of glaze and it's sweet. Just using descriptors versus judgment in kind of describing the food. And this helps us reconnect with food in a really natural and sensory way, moving away from that kind of good, bad attitude.
I heard you mention leaning on your village when mm-hmm. making nutrition decisions. Talk about that concept of mindfulness eating.
Yeah, so leaning on your village, I think as a parent or caregiver during the holidays, you can feel like there's so much to coordinate, so much to do, and you can feel overwhelming. And one of the things I want to remind our parents and caregivers that when it comes to feeding your children, lean on your village. Ask for help. Ask your family, your friends. And if you don't feel like you have a village, find one or build one. It could be virtual. It could be your sports group or a local support group that you go to. So this can be really helpful in that when you kind of relieve some of the stress of coordinating day-to-day life, you create space to tune into what your body is telling you, being more mindful and creating an environment where you can tune into that intuitive eating approach.
Vanus, is there anything you'd like to add for our listeners?
There's many right paths to desired goal. Ultimately, the goal here is to have some structure, communicate with your body, understand hunger and satiety, ask for help from others when you need it, and build up a healthy relationship with food and your body that you can model for your children and that you can all foster for life. So next holiday season, there's no need to stress around holiday eating for your kids.
Vanus, if you would, give us a website where we can learn more and about some of these concepts you've been talking about this morning and also about Stanford Children's Health.
Absolutely. Well, there is a website called intuitiveeating.org if you wanted to check that out and learn more about the concepts I've talked about today. There are a couple authors also out there, Ellen Satter and Christy Harrison, who talk a lot more about this sustainable and more intuitive approach to nutrition. In terms of getting connected with nutrition services here at Stanford Children's Health, you can go onto stanfordchildrens.org and search in the search bar for nutrition.
Well, I appreciate you joining us here on Health Professional Radio this morning. It's been a pleasure speaking with you, Vanus. Thank you so much.
Thank you, Neil. It's been a pleasure being here. Thank you once again.
You've been listening to Health Professional Radio. I'm your host, Neil Howard, in conversation with Vanus Kalami. Audio copies of this program are available at hpr.fm and healthprofessionalradio.com.au. You can also subscribe to the podcast on iTunes, listen in, download at SoundCloud, and be sure and subscribe to our YouTube channel at youtube.com/healthprofessionalradio.